Hey, everybody. Welcome to episode 47 of Talkin' Trash. My name's Tim, and I'm an addict. Hi, Tim. We're themed to recognize National Recovery Month, but on this day, 23 years ago, one of the most horrific events in American history and world history took place. The attack remains one of the most traumatic events of the century, not only for Americans, but also for the world. I was 19 at the time. I was late for work, and I was driving my VW Jetta when I heard the radio interruption about the attack. Four planes flying over the eastern U.S. were seized simultaneously by small teams of hijackers. They were then used as giant guided missiles to crash into landmark buildings in New York and Washington. The first plane hit the North Tower at 8:46 a.m. Eastern Time. The second hit the South Tower at 9:03 a.m. Eastern Time. At 9:37, another plane hit the western face of the Pentagon. The fourth plane that was hijacked, the passengers fought back and downed the plane in a field in Pennsylvania. So as we remember the events on September 11th, 2001, we're also riding the wave of Recovery Awareness Month. National Overdose Day was at the end of August, then National Recovery Month, which we're in and we're all about, and last but not least, Suicide Prevention Week, which we're right in the middle of. We're passionate here on Talkin' Trash about everything that I formerly mentioned, and we're here to spread the message of addiction, mental health, recovery, suicide prevention, and more. So thanks for being with us here on 9/11. We appreciate your support, and you know, it's just it's a tough day for Americans. So we remember our fallen comrades, and we stand as one country united together. I've asked a friend to read our preamble.
This is our preamble that we read. This is our humble broadcast where ethics and personal anonymity are of the utmost importance. We run this podcast as an act of service to those whose lives have been affected by addiction. We don't do it for profit or notoriety. We place principles before personalities. We benefit from this podcast just as much as anyone else. We are transparent about our journeys. We have no expectations or benchmarks set. Our work is in God's hands, who is first and foremost in both our lives and our recovery. It's a privilege to be a part of the recovery community as a mouthpiece for those touched by the disease and are without a voice. We all work programs and choose to sacrifice our own anonymity to spread the message that recovery is possible. We do this thing in an attempt to show as living examples that no matter how far down the scale we have gone, we will see how our experience can benefit others. Not only is that the fifth step promise, it's our creed we abide by here on Talkin' Trash. We feel called to uphold AA and NA principles. We firmly believe that you can only keep what you have by giving it away.
Join us for a moment of silence for the still sick and suffering, followed by the Serenity Prayer. God, grant us the serenity to accept the things we cannot change, the courage to change the things we can, and the wisdom to know the difference. All right, so let's go around and meet the team of Talkin' Trash. You got Mike Oxley, LPN. He's an addiction recovery nurse. He's a stroke survivor. He brings a lot of knowledge to the table, and he has a colorful way about him. There's Tim Snyder, that's me. I'm 41 years old, I'm the father to two beautiful women. I'm your host of Talkin' Trash and the producer of the broadcast. And you got Tommy Wilkes. He's 37 years old, he's very smart, he lives in Atlanta, he's handsome, and he's very ticklish. So we're gonna go around the horn here and check in with everybody. Tommy, what's happening?
Tommy Wilkes, and I'm a recovering alcoholic. Great to be with you. You know, just quickly on the preamble, you know, talking about, you know, just using our experience to help others, no matter how far the scale, you know, we have gone. And, you know, that's what, you know, we're here to do on this podcast is to help others and help y'all. And, you know, just wanted to mention that. And so we're talking about recovery all month, and you know, wanted to mention that without addiction, there is no recovery. And that's where we come in. We bridge the gap between the two and offer varying opinions on both sides of the matter. I'm an alcoholic in recovery. Tim's an addict and alcoholic in recovery, and Mike's a longtime nurse in the recovery field. And then tonight we also have our good friend Will Douglas on. Yay. So now let's formally meet the rest of the team.
Let's do it.
We've got Mike Oxley next. How are you doing, Mike?
Hey, how are you guys doing? I feel like it's been a while since we chatted, a while since we saw Will. Yeah. But I'm okay. Today's a little special day for me. You know, it was 23 years ago. That's hard to believe. Mm-hmm. I know where I was, as everybody knows where they were that day. It was also my anniversary. Of course, we were married before 2001. It was like my eighth wedding anniversary at that time in 2001 to my first wife. And, you know, so it always kind of had a, well, hey, we might as well call it like it is. The marriage was doomed. It was doomed. That blew up too. That really blew up too. But anyway, unlike 9/11, there is no memorial set. But I think it's odd about myself is that I've never been to the memorial, the 9/11 memorial, and we're talking it's less than 2 hours from my home. I always say to myself, it's too soon, it's too soon. But it's been 23 years, and my knee-jerk reaction to that is, it's too soon. So you don't have to actually be involved or experience it firsthand to have trauma. And I think there's trauma when I think about at 23 years that I can say it's still too soon to go to the monument up there. I just figured that out while live on television right now. But, you know, I'm going to explore that a little bit. But how are things with you, Tim?
With me, I'm pretty good. I don't know what I'm doing here tonight. I changed the format up a little bit here on my podcasting thing, and it's all different. So, like, thanks a lot, StreamYard.
Tim, yeah, second show in a row, purple shirt.
I'm back off short.
This is a male purple shirt this time.
Is it staying on this time?
We'll see
I remember that.
We'll see where we go.
That was hilarious.
See where
you look
go.
Like Grimace.
Yeah, well, I feel like Grimace. It's a beautiful shirt, though. It's so comfortable. It's polyester. I love the way it makes me feel.
All right, the second rub was too much.
Okay, so yeah, I'm here. I'm fine. Let's see what's going on with me. I'm just focusing on Recovery Month. It's like... I do this 24/7, basically. So, like, it's nice going to my meetings and having people... I hear people talking about the podcast, and then they come up to me, and they're like, what happened this time with the podcast? What happened there? What did you guys do? That was funny. That wasn't funny. That was mean. Whatever it was, people are talking about it, like, just random people. And I'm telling you, I never advertised it. That was a strict rule for me. I would never go into AA and say, hey, I got a podcast you guys might want to watch. That comes off very pretentious, you know, so I never shared it with anybody. And
self-serving.
Well, so, yeah, it is. It's getting there. Like, I don't have to do as much on social media. But, like, I think I gave it to one girl because I think she saw us somehow. And I don't know. And I gave her my card, which is a cool card. You just QR code the back of it. And, you know, so now all of a sudden... people want the cards. You know, you just take a picture of the back of it. It's a sweet, sweet design. So anyway, I don't know. There's not much of us out there. We're pretty niche. You know what I mean? We're pretty rare. There's some addiction podcasts, but it's usually like a doctor talking about addiction, or like there's a couple I found, but there's none really other than us, which is great. So we're very happy about that. Let's see, what are we gonna do? Oh, my friend Tommy Wilkes. He is our co-host. He's 37 years young. He's been clean since 10/13/23. It's coming, almost there. Atlanta, Georgia, he hails from. His drug of choice is booze and amphetamines. Whose isn't? And he's an accountant with great flow. I don't know. I think I do that, and then I do... Nope. I'll figure it out. Look at... I'm clicking. Okay. Let me get rid of my... I just got rid of Mike.
Oh,
he's
no.
Just gone.
Oh,
sorry, Mike.
It's fine.
He's
I think it's the hat.
I guess so.
Go Braves.
That was funny. Anyway, so so what we got going on here, just kind of hang out, do our thing. We're going to watch some shorts, which I think is great.
It brings us back. It does. To how far we've come.
Yeah, so it's just, it's nice where we've gone, and we like to look back at some fun times we had, and some rough times, but like, I'm sure there's a short of Mike showing his ass. I don't know if I have that. That was very funny.
I wasn't showing my ass. I was showing my tattoo.
I'm looking for this short from last episode. I can't find it on my own computer. I've completely lost all control.
It's okay.
I know. I should just be able to click, and we're done. But no, not so much. So anyway, it's National Recovery Month, and that's what we're really focused on. Next week's theme is home, like your environment. I'm looking forward to that on Sunday because that's a big thing, too. We did health on Sunday, and we kind of spun that into mental health. That's what we thought was most important. Yeah, sure, you can eat spinach and, you know, drink water and do whatever and go for runs. But, like, health to us meant mental health because that's the idea to start using comes from, you know. So, like, for us, we've been through it. Dual diagnosis, co-occurring conditions, all that stuff. We boiled down to mental health. And I liked our spin on it. So, yeah, so that's that. Will, how are you doing? What's going on in your world?
I'm doing great. Been working a lot more. Hey. I've been working with my brother, but it's gotten slow. But I started answering to people on Facebook, you know, that needed yard work done or stuff, because I used to do landscaping and lawn maintenance. And it's kind of like I went and helped one lady out, and then she like referred me to like her cousin. It's kind of blossomed from there. So I've been it's been picking up a lot. So yeah,
the best kind of reference there is. That means you're doing a good job, buddy.
Yeah.
And I think that even doing that, it's going to even expand even more. I mean, like, because, you know, I like to talk. So therefore, there's more avenues even with the people that I'm helping that have other businesses that I can, you know, with the washing and stuff. So, yeah, it's been doing good.
Well, when did you start using drugs? What age?
Like real drugs or like
fake ones?
Well, I started smoking pot when I was 14.
Okay.
But then I was held back a year, so ninth grade. It was first day of freshman.
No, I'm sorry. Seventh grade. If you're held back.
I'm sorry to laugh at other people's
if you got held back, it would be seventh.
Anyhow, so...
we know. Was it because of math?
No. What?
You probably didn't go to school.
No, I wasn't messing around, you know? But No, then I started, was about 17, 18 is when I started, like, I dabbled in, like, ecstasy, whatever, but as soon as I graduated high school, it was, like,
Blue Dolphin.
Cocaine for 6 months, and then it was meth, you know, and GHB. Yeah.
What is GHB again?
Isn't that a daily drug?
Roofing.
Oh, it's roofing. Yeah. You told us that. I didn't know people took that recreationally until we had you on the show.
I didn't know either. Yeah.
Well, so the thing is, like I was telling you before, you know how like people do like speedball, like they do heroin and or coke, whatever. So meth complements G and G. I mean, like they complement each other, you know.
Kind of like in my generation, Netflix and Viagra.
Sure. Your generation.
But the G is dangerous. I mean, people don't realize. I mean, it's dangerous. I mean, I've OD'd more than a few times, you know. Mm. It's with what you mix it with. People don't know. Like when you put it in alcohol, that's like a deadly combination. That's why you.
Yeah. Yep.
You know, but
so wait, you're date rape drugging yourself?
Yeah. Yes.
Hell yeah.
Yep.
It makes sense to me.
That's a good time too.
I get it. I mean,
date rape drug yourself.
I mean, if you get the mixture the right.
Yes. You're just going. You're yeah.
There's awesome, and then there's dead right after awesome.
There's so like, close you know, you're straddling the fence.
It's rough. Why wouldn't you just take Xanax or something? Like, what is GHB?
GHB is so cheap for the amount. I mean, like, you can get it, and it's easy to hide because it's a clear
liquid. It's like a horse tranquilizer?
Oh, it's a clear liquid?
It's, no. I can't. Yeah, it's like a... There's different, there's like two different kinds, or whatever, but it's really a steroid. I mean, like, because to use it because it wouldn't show up on drug tests. Now, if you take it, you can pass a drug test because you have to specifically be tested for GHB and it has to be within a six hour window of you actually taking it. So a lot of people will take it to skate drug test. But I mean, I watched a documentary type thing on it was the party scene like over in Europe. The very large thing over there. I mean, I remember one time I took too much whatever, and like I woke up a couple of days later in ICU. You know, and I mean, as soon as I woke up, I knew it had happened, and I ripped them things out of my arm. And they're like, "What's your mother's phone number?" I said, "Oh no, no, you ain't getting that number." Like, no, but I had to give it to them. But I mean,
it's often known as liquid ecstasy or blue nitro.
That's crazy that it comes in a liquid form. So if you're trying to give this to a girl at a bar, like,
most of the time it's tasteless.
What do you do? Carry it in a Visine bottle? How do you do this?
Oh my god! I mean, the things that I have put it in, like, people used to know when they got in my car, do not use. There'll be a bottle in the center, like with a cup holder is, you know, with that Gatorade or a Coke bottle. Don't drink out of that. Out of it. And you only take a little. Like, people, depending on the strength of it, like, say this is how I. People take, like, they'll measure it with the, like, you know, with a syringe, not with the needle part, but, you know, the syringe, you know. And that was just too much. I would get, like, a chapstick cap of a chapstick. And if it was really good, you could just fill that up, and that was all you needed. But, I mean, your tolerance builds up to it. I mean, there's a lot of people I know that have died from it. People at the clubs, that, you know, they would take it and do way too much of it, you know. And plus, it'll make you, like, if you don't realize, if you're doing physical activity, you will have a heat stroke from taking it, you know, because you'll get so hot and sweaty and not realize it. But
it's crazy. So I'm looking at it. I'm looking at all the things I can find. Mike, have you ever heard of just a central nervous system depressant drug? Like, usually everything is.
Oh, yeah. A lot of the relax pre-anesthetics that your father would use, even at work, or nervous system depressants, a whole host of them. And then to slowly bring you out of being actually out through a some kind of drug would gradually bring you back, and they would use, so you didn't flip out and start shaking or convulsing. Yeah. They would use a nervous system depression. Some of the nervous system depressants are like anti, what is that called? Epilepsy. Epileptic drugs. On a smaller scale, but sometimes coming out of anesthesia.
So let me ask you, can you compare it to a drug that maybe I would know? Like, I don't know, propofol or I don't even know. Is there a Versed? Is there a drug like GHB? Because I'm looking at something right now. It says
a little fentanyl, maybe.
GHB is Rohypnol.
Rohypnol.
GHB is often manufactured in homes with recipes and kits found and purchased. This is a. I don't understand. I've never come across this. Wait. Rohypnol and GHB are two different things.
Or they'll call it Georgia Homeboy.
Yes.
They'll call what?
The nickname here is Georgia Homeboy.
It's a GHB. Central nervous system depressant. Other CNS depressants include antidepressants, antipsychotic drugs, GHB, and Rohypnol.
Well, Rohypnol is a benzodiazepine. I'm looking at it right now. I just saw the...
Benzodiazepine and barbiturates fall in under central nervous system depressants is what I'm reading.
Yes, they do. Yeah, I know. I'm just looking at...
That's the whole class.
So like Xanax, Valium.
Yeah, I get all those
Halcyon
drugs.
Halcyon or whatever that is.
Halcyon. I get all. I'm looking at Rohypnol. It's a flutriazepam. Anything with a PAM or azepam or, you know, that's usually a benzo. I guess I didn't really think about the CNS. I just thought benzo was a CNS, but I guess it is.
So
I'm wondering, like, benzos are CNS, wouldn't GHB fall into a different category, or is it a street?
It's saying
drug?
It falls under CNS.
Okay, that's weird because like a lot of things fall under CNS. Like, I don't know.
Well, there's different strengths too.
I get it. Yeah. But anyway, that's fun. So what's the rape drug? Gamma hydroxylic butyric acid or Rohypnol?
Both,
actually.
Both.
Okay. Oh, that makes sense then. Good. So I'm glad we all figured out that. It's a great thing for our listeners. The listenership is going to go through the roof on this one. Jesus Christmas.
Education today.
Yeah. So, I just as a disclaimer, do not rape anybody or use these drugs. That is Talkin' Trash's motto and creed, no rape. None. Not even a little. Not happening. So anyway, we got a couple emails that are rough. I thought maybe we would get to them and see where everybody's heads are at. But first, let's go through a couple of shorts. And we're going to go back to the early days with Tommy. This is a fun one. Tommy's just, I think this is his first appearance on Talkin' Trash. Here we go.
Tom, you're much better looking than on our clean time photo. In person, you might want to talk to Tim about redoing that photo of you.
What's funny is that clean time photo, I had to crop out the glass of wine he was holding.
So that was fun.
Tim was nice to me back then.
Yeah. Oh, would you stop it?
Jesus Christ. I got a fun one, too. We'll talk about that after. I have a fun one as well.
Mike, what were you going to say?
Oh, yeah. No, you talk.
I think you're ovulating. But I was going to say about the emails that Tim was alluding to. I thought he was doing that next, and then we got sidetracked. I didn't know.
Said he was going to play some shorts, and then that.
Okay.
I mean, this one I'm not sure is going to work. All right, boys, here's the surprise. Here on Talkin' Trash, and this is just company policy, we do random drug tests on our co-hosts. All right, no swapping pee. You will be watched when you take the test by thousands of people. If Mike was a mushroom, he would be...
eaten.
A fun guy to be with.
That's good.
I made that one up. How many teeth does a snail have, Tommy?
Zero.
14,000. Close. Very close. The legal limit for alcohol. This is fun. It's designed to make you both look like jerk-offs. What is the generic name of Suboxone?
Hydrocodone.
No. Buprenorphine.
Oh, right.
Tommy, what is the generic name for Percocet?
Hydrocodone.
How many times are you guys going to guess hydrocodone? Mike, what are two things you can't have for dinner?
I personally?
Yeah, just in general, as a human being, what are two things you can't have for dinner?
Metal and plastic.
Ah, breakfast and lunch, dummy. What has a spine but no bones, Tommy?
What has a spine but no bones? A snake?
A book, Thomas. Oh my god. StreamYard, you're killing me. Anyway, that was funny. That was an impromptu one. They didn't know that one was coming, and it was fun. It was a good time.
Since we're just kind of throwing things around, can I ask all three of you guys that are in recovery an important question? Hmm. Because I'm not in recovery, because I've never felt that I compelled enough, other than I can barely relate it to, but I guess you can relate it to cigarettes. There's not a day that goes by that I don't think about cigarettes. There's not a day that goes by that I don't want a cigarette. I've been off them since the stroke. That day was my last cigarette. And I'm being honest. Look, if I'm comparing apples and oranges or whatever, I don't physically crave it. Mentally, I crave cigarettes still. And again, this is why I said never to my patients, never quit smoking when you quit using drugs and alcohol at the same time, because you're going to relate one to the other. But, and that's an old episode, but I think about it. I'm actually planning my next cigarette, my relapse. Like, I wonder, like, I said to myself, okay, in the last 5 minutes, the urge goes away. And then I say, well, how about the day my mom dies? God forgive me. But how about the day she dies? Am I planning? Well, first thing I'm going to do when my mom dies is go buy a pack of cigarettes. What makes me think like that? What is that normal thought for somebody that was addicted to cigarettes for 35 years, a year and a half later? I don't think that's normal. The stress is going to come, is what I'm saying. And that's always been what I felt was my stress reliever. And I guess I still think it. I can't wait for something bad to happen to have an excuse to have a cigarette. There, I said it.
Good.
Tim, you can go ahead.
I mean, no, it's interesting. I haven't smoked a cigarette in 11 months, right? And when I pull up to the gas station, it's in my head, I don't smoke anymore. I identified it a few weeks ago when I pulled into a gas station. I was like, man, I could use a cigarette. I didn't have a vape on me, whatever. And it just, I look back and I'm like, I haven't had that thought in forever. And I'm like, I don't smoke. And that was easy for me to just be, and I know it sounds... you know, unattainable, but like maybe it's because I constantly have drug dreams and I'm constantly thinking about my past and you know, I'm a mess, you know what I mean? But in my head, I don't smoke anymore. You know what I mean? I can't say I don't use drugs anymore because the minute I say that, I'll get high. So like, it's just, it's one of those things where I have to, for the drugs, I have to stay on top of it because I'll never get over it. That's a lifetime.
And I'm not comparing the two, drugs and cigarettes, although some people do. But I'm telling you, it was hard to get rid of, but I still think that I actually retarded my own driving ability after the stroke. I've actually not driven on purpose, I feel, in the back of my mind, because I knew I was going to stop at Wawa, which is a Jersey thing. I knew I was going to go to Wawa and buy a pack. Or I was scared. Let me say this. I was scared I was going to go to Wawa and buy a pack. So I slowly kind of retarded my driving a little bit because of it. I didn't want to drive because that was going to be my first stop.
Yeah.
It's insane. I'm waiting for bad news to have a cigarette, for a tragedy to happen. That's like, crazy. That's how – I just want to know if that's how addicts feel – when they're off of their drug of choice, be it alcohol, be it coke, be it heroin, do you wait for bad news to use constantly? Or do you just use because you want to?
No, I've been living bad news for the last year and a half. Everything's bad news. So I have to stay on top of that. But like, no, I moved from New Jersey to Georgia. That's what it took. 700 miles it took for me to put up that wall. And yeah, I don't know. I mean, Mike, that's incredible. You can absolutely identify with the addict with what you just shared. It's incredible to me.
When they say cigarettes are the most addictive, there's more addictive than
drugs. I have cigarette dreams. 35 years, two packs a day. I mean, that's a lot of smokes. Big expense,
you wanna
too.
You want to know something crazy?
I almost had to start tricking. Go ahead.
So anytime that I've been arrested, it's funny. Anytime I've been arrested, it's like as soon as I get locked up, I know in my mind I can't smoke a cigarette, so I don't even want them. Like, I don't even think about a cigarette. Because I'm in jail, and I know I can't have them. I know I'm not going to get it. I mean, I may, but I'm not getting a cigarette. So I don't even – it's like mentally in my mind, it's gone.
Yeah.
But as soon as I step out that door, guess what? Shoot, I got a cigarette, you know?
Yeah. The 10th step promise is that we'll be free of wanting alcohol. You know, I mean
– recoil
I know
from it like a hot flame.
I know some people that swear by it, and I know some people that are like, I did 12 steps three times, and I still want to get drunk. And they're sober 4 years or whatever. So, like, it varies from person to person. But yeah, I mean, I find it hard to believe, personally. I've never done the 12 steps. I just find it hard to believe that will fix me in that regard. And I'm in a group, and I'm a group leader, and I chair meetings. You know, the only requirement to join is to stop drinking or to want to stop drinking. Yeah. So I live on that. But like, yeah, maybe if I did them right, I don't know. But the obsession to stop drinking or stop using, I mean, is it just going to stop my drug dreams? I feel like they're wired into me. I have rewired my brain negatively. I have to fight that every single day. It's not like cigarettes. Cigarettes, for some reason, I'm like, I don't smoke anymore. Dunzo. This is... I battle it. You know, I don't want to get high. I mean, yeah, I do want to get high. I absolutely want to get high. I have, you know, I think back to the times I got high and where my mind was at. And I don't, usually I think of, when I think I want to get high, I think of the destruction behind me.
Risk versus reward. Risk versus
right.
reward.
Again. But I tend to not think of, you know, all the destruction. I'm just thinking about the fleeting moment of getting high. And I identify that when it happens. And I flip that switch and I'm like, no, that fleeting moment of getting high leads to a million other and, you know, crashes and burns and family members and this, that, and the other thing. So that's where I come to. But, you know, I still have that feeling and it's ingrained in me because I dream about it. I live in the past, unfortunately. I try not to, but I do. Yeah, it's hard. I've lost a lot. I've destroyed a lot. And, you know, it's tough to crawl out from under that rock. And now a lot of this sounds like self-pity. It's really not. It's self-identifying thing.
Yeah, what you've learned so far and what you're trying to still learn and follow.
So I don't, right. You know, we do not wish to repeat the past, but we don't wish to shut the door on it either. That's an AA saying. And that means, you know, keep the door open a crack so you can see you can see what you've done and make better decisions going forward, but it doesn't say open the whole door and stare behind you, because you will hit something in front of you. So yeah, it's hard. I still have these dreams. I had one last night. It was exhausting. It was just running around. I can't even explain it. I'm not going to try to. I'm just running around. I'm in the air in a balloon. I'm trying to get drugs. My needle broke. You know, I drew my drugs out of the hot air balloon. Then we land and I go and try and find the drugs. And then there's some Indian family feed me Indian food. And then I find more drugs. And it was insane. Like, that was last night. That's just one night. I have all the time just like that. So, like, I don't know. I feel like it's ingrained in me. Holy shit, we're 45 minutes. How did that happen? I saw a Sweetwater 420 sitting next to the refrigerator the other day. It made me laugh. Vicky,
is that some kind of liqueur, a Sweetwater 420?
It's a beer. Pale ale.
Oh, because 420 is also marijuana. That's
it
why
is.
I don't know
why the correlation.
Bring
is
it infused? And, with...
No, but right. Sweetwater does make it a cannabis-infused beer.
Oh, how about that? I want that.
All right.
So, like, that's funny. Like, my mom knows that I'm not going to drink. I don't want to drink. She can have wine in here. She can have a Sweetwater 420. It won't even cross my mind. Drinking didn't cross my mind when I saw the can. It's just certain things I'm just not going to do anymore. And that's just it. It's in my mind that I'm not doing these anymore. They're not good for me. However, there's times where I think I can just have one more. And I can't. And that's something I have to come to terms with. And I'm still trying to this day. So I put myself in an environment where I can't call the dope man. I can't walk down the street. And, you know, hopefully I overcome this as well as I overcome cigarettes and all that. So, yeah, I'm a work in progress. I'm not going to hide it. So, you know, Mike, you want to do some clean time?
Yeah. Let's give people credit that are doing the right thing.
Let's rock and roll this bitch.
John Brown Sr. Wow, Threadchip, 32 days. Congratulations, Johnny.
Attaboy.
Valencia K, 37 days. You're doing awesome. Katarina D, 37 days and nights.
I call dibs.
April A. April R, 40 days. Monty Fontanello, 45 days. There's getting to be some real time there. Monty. And there's our buddy, Michaela Booker. I'm so proud of her. Frank Kenny with them spooky mirror frame things. 50 days. That's no joke. Rico Suave, again, no joke. 51 days. Look at you, Ronnie J. He's still one of our newer guys, but he's plugging right along at 51 days. Alex, look at you. Went to green. You're in it. You're welcome to the club, buddy. Alex Petrine. Samantha. Unbelievable. Look at you, Miss Hess. You are in the green. Anthony, you are in the green. That's fantastic. Destiny, 71 days. Way to go. Daniel G, 80 days. That's amazing.
Amen.
AJ Hamilton, 84 days. That's no joke, man.
Nope.
Andreas Estrada, 86 days. These people are putting on some time. Look at this. Yeah. David D, next time we see him, he'll be 100 days. I'm just shocked.
Christian.
He's at 100 right now. Christian A, fantastic. And there she is, Tara Dixon, at 100 already. She's doing fantastic. I like to talk to them. They're moving fast or slow. 102 for Alex M.
I'll fix it.
There's Nikki Starnes, 104 days. 105 days for Crikey's from Australia, Steve W. There he is, Tony J. Getting an Indian summer in, big boy. 136 days. And Maria Gladden, 136 days and nights. Jared Black, 147 days. That's crazy. That's wonderful.
That's how long we've been doing this.
I know. Mandy Jean, Kissy Girl, 175 days. Proud of you. 176 days. Jamie Michelle, I'm proud of her. 198 days to Sean Booker. That's no joke, man. There he is, Ricky McVicker, 226 days and laps. And there is KDM, 273 or 9 months, which means if she got pregnant on the day she quit, she would have given birth already. 280 days, 9 months, Aunt Patty.
The fuck is wrong with you?
I'm just saying, it's a long pregnancy. 285, Frank C.
Oh, no.
336 days, Tommy Wilkes.
Like he's revved up.
There he is, Willie Vanilli. 340 days. There he is, Garrett Mentuck. 560 days. Tim Snyder, our leader and senior, got in there. 540 days. Amelia Quattro, 2 years and change. So nice.
Yeah.
2 years, Stella. Did you ever think we'd be talking in years? Mm-mm. Huh, April? Look at you. 3 years last month. Fantastic.
Yeah, man.
There he is. I know we kid a lot with Jeff. 3 years is a good sport and a good sober guy.
Good dude.
6 years, Lisa Welke. And change. She's doing really well. And our buddy, Tina. 8 years. 12 years. I talked to Matt today, actually. I got a group message from Matt today.
He's
13 years and change, Neil K.
Mike, what's the most important part of any meeting?
The newcomers or the donuts.
Oh, yeah.
15 days, Hallie McDermott. Way to go, Hal. Skylar S., 20 days. Fantastic. Congrats.
Keep coming back. It works.
Keep coming back.
Work it. If you want to be on Clean Time, send me an email, tim@trash-podcast.com, or through our socials, Spotify, Apple Music, Facebook, YouTube, TikTok, Instagram, and get yourself some Narcan because it could save a life. Yeah, man, I do love some Clean Time, boy.
Especially National Recovery Month. I like to see people just going on. I didn't mean the time for the guests, fast or slow. I like to talk to some of our Clean Time people to find out for them, is it going fast or slow? I know it's going fast for me.
That's a good idea. I talked to like four of these people this week.
Okay.
Ronnie J. Mm-hmm. I talked to Alex Petrine. I talked to Stella Montez. She sent us an email that she's going to be 3 years or something soon.
Very soon. Good for her.
And who else did I hear from? Somebody in the years section. A guy. I don't know. It was like four emails. Maybe it was three. But
Jeff? Neil? Jeff?
I think it was Neil K. He sent me an email.
Okay.
Yep. And I check in with all our Clean Timers. I have a list in my inbox, and I go through it and I send them a message. How you doing? That's all it says. And for the 90% of the time, they come back and they say, I'm doing great. I'm still on the wagon. I'm doing good, blah, blah, blah. So, I mean, yeah, reality, probably a few of those 40-something people have relapsed at this point, and I don't know about it. And that's kind of the reality of this business. We have.
But
to,
about the honesty and the taking accountability for your actions, a few times they've reached out to us before we did know, our viewers in America did know, and were accountable right to us, and we took them back down to one, and it was no big deal. It happens all the time.
Yeah,
that makes me even more proud.
Listen,
when they do that.
The other realistic thing is, because we're keeping track of their time and they watch our show, that could also keep them sober. Just like they see it on their TV screen every week, twice a week,
right? Twice
and
a week.
Like,
to
yep,
right, right.
You're right. I'm three more days, and you know that is enough to, you know, I don't want to pat ourselves in the back too much.
No.
The reality is,
I think it's great.
The reality is some people relapse, some people don't give a shit, and some people use it as motivation. I'm positive of
you
that.
Know, like, I'm just not a podcast host, and I can't speak for you guys, but especially our Clean Time people, I feel personally vested in them. Like,
yep.
I feel so excited. Like, I'm just vested in them. I'm proud. I'm happy. I wish they all lived in town here. I could ride by and send them a note and, you know, give them a high five. You
oh,
know,
I got to say real quick, I'm sorry, Jen Magner. I forgot to put you in Clean Time. Jen Magner, 142 days, almost pushing 9 months. You'll be in the next segment. Very sweet girl. So, yeah, I don't know.
Emails?
Yeah, we'll get to those real quick. Yeah, let's do emails. All right, I picked out two that were just rough. They were just rough. Michelle Parks from Love Ladies, New Jersey. I recently lost a son to overdose. Ready for this? At 12 years old. Okay, let that sink in for a second. She's asking us, how do I move on? I'm devastated and don't know what to do. I mean, Jesus Christmas. Anybody can feel that question.
First of all, let's find out why. Let's find out, was it somebody else using? He got into it by accident. Was it fentanyl and he touched it through touch transfer? Did he hear it glorified somewhere? Did he hear it from school? Is there an older family member, a cousin, somebody's brother or sister that he's friendly with who glorified this stuff? Is it the media? Let's find all that out. But the first thing that has to be done is forgive yourself. Right. Forgive yourself. It's everywhere. Mm-hmm. It's everywhere. So she needs to forgive herself, number one. Yeah. She needs some grief help. She needs some grief counseling. She needs to see a therapist about it. I think after the email, I may need to see a therapist about it.
Shit.
But it is mainstream, so it's not as crazy as I'm being 12. I'm kind of surprised there's not more of it, unfortunately, as widespread as it is and as much media attention as it gets now and as much glorifying as it gets of the older brothers or sisters using or cousins or people they look up to using. I'm surprised that it's not left for more people to get into. And I mean literally get into it and see what it's about. But grief counseling, she needs to forgive herself. It's not her fault. As far as I know, it's not her fault. But it makes no sense, I know. But knowing the epidemic that's going on in America right now, it does make sense. And it's horrifying. It's scary. And I know you told us to let other people know, obviously. You told us to let everybody know. And I'm telling you, I'm doing that right now.
Yeah.
Did everybody hear what I said? I'm surprised it doesn't happen more with his widespread and becoming glorified as fentanyl does. Mm-hmm. That these 12-year-olds not trying to be bigger than they are. Tough guys are going to try it and be cool. Well, you know what I'm saying. What happens to the cool kids sometimes.
I think about Love Ladies, LBI. I mean, it's – oh, actually it is – all right, I guess so. I'm thinking it's November and it's dead down there, but it is the end of the – it's Indian summer. It's the end of the – I guess –
it's the end. Kids are back to school, so yeah. Your transients and your chubies, as we call them, are all home. This may be a regular property owner.
Yeah, I don't – I mean, whatever. It just is what it is. Go get some
grief counseling. It's an affluent area. It
yeah,
is.
And it's rich. I know it's rich, but like
– but it doesn't matter. Rich, poor, this happened to this woman, and that's just
– and it could be as simple as he's a good kid – but decided he was going to try one of mommy's pills. And I don't know. I don't know that, like you said, we don't know the details around it, but that's a rough one, 12 years old.
I would also check out Narnon, because then you have a lot of like-minded people that have family members, you know, with any kind of situation, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good point. Any kind of support group, even online, on Zoom, you got to let your walls down. And that is really hard after your son overdoses. I'll bet you blame the shit out of yourself. I'll bet you do. I would. I would probably.
Oh, yeah. I'm telling her not to, but I would. I wish she lived around the corner. I could do more. I mean, reach out. Get my email address. Oh, my God. I'm just.
Maybe I'll. Am
I on camera and is my jaw on the floor right now?
Yeah, you have no jaw.
Because I feel like. It should be down like that when you hear about a 12-year-old. But she told us for a reason. She told us so the people that are watching this learn from that and know that it can happen to a 12-year-old.
All that she could get out is one sentence or two sentences. That's all she could do. Makes sense.
I get it. Sure. That's all she needed was the two sentences because, you know, all of our viewers now know it and know should be as – listen. They could be watching us high as a kite right now, but they are as shocked as we are right now also. Everybody that just heard us say that is just as shocked at a 12-year-old from Love Ladies is dead because of it. Unbelievable.
That's brutal. Well, listen, I mean, our heart goes out to you, Michelle. Maybe I'll respond to your email and CC Mike and Tommy so maybe we can all get involved in this because it's I don't like it. It leaves a really bad taste in my mouth. And I think back to when my daughters were 12, and I experienced that. I experienced that age twice, right? I had two daughters, 3 years apart in age. And I remember 12 years old, and they were rebellious, and they were angry and just hormonal and all that stuff. And but they were not anywhere near using drugs. I mean, they were upset because, you know, the Super Nintendo or the Nintendo, the Switch didn't work, or like little things. They never...
Hannah Montana was canceled.
Exactly, right. That kind of stuff. Or I'm not getting pancakes for breakfast. I know for a fact that let me see what Daddy has in his drawer. I want to take it. It wasn't even on the table. So how did that happen, Michelle? I'm not yelling at you. I'm just asking for details because other people's 12-year-olds could be in jeopardy, you know, and that's legitimate. And, you know, I don't know your situation. If you're from Love Ladies, you're probably a little more affluent than most, you know, but it's scary. I mean, it is really...
It doesn't matter what you have in a bank.
No, it really doesn't. I'm just saying, like, yeah, I don't know what I'm saying. But yeah, it's...
They got to start educating these kids in, what, fourth grade about fentanyl? If that's what it takes, that's what it takes. Yeah. If it takes kindergarten, I guess. I mean, I'm shocked. But when I look at the big picture, like we just said, shocked. But am I shocked? As widespread as it is and as bad as it is, it should hit home on a couple fronts.
Well,
one that it happened, one that it can happen, and one that it will continue to happen.
It's easy to see it on the news and just be like, oh, how could that be? It's another thing when somebody emails us and tells us about it. Like, you kidding me? Like, I don't know.
We just told how many viewers about it, so hopefully they're going to pass it on.
Yeah, do whatever you got to do. Look at your medicine cabinet. Educate your kids. Whatever you got to do to bring this statistic down, because this is rough. I mean, these kids are using it 12 years old. These kids are... Is that the climate right now? Like, I know my daughters could get high and get drugs anytime they want, and they saw what I went through, and they will not. I know that. But at the same time, who the hell knows?
Agreed.
You never know. You never know. I think the next one we got to read real quick too. Michael Brown, he's binge drinking. He's from Lake Havasu City in Arizona or
in Nevada.
Nevada.
It's where Girls Gone Wild is filmed.
Yes, Girls Gone Wild.
I know it's a party thing. Are you sure it's not Arizona?
No, it's Nevada.
I thought it was Arizona.
Okay.
Maybe Arizona, but I'm pretty sure it's Nevada.
All right. Well, I'm gonna look.
I was in rehab in Las Vegas with a guy from Lake Havasu that was an alcoholic. Yeah.
Well, I'm about to. I can't not look it up.
Google it.
It is in Arizona.
My bad. I lied.
You're bad. So anyway,
I wonder if he was American
it's
Indian.
It's close by.
It is close. It's right down the road. Yeah. So I don't know. It's just you know, this guy. Oh yeah. He got a DUI. His girlfriend left him. And I barely remember the last few days. I've been binge drinking. I'm just coming around now. I listen to your show a lot, and I feel like I have nowhere to go or what to do. Please help.
Well, he's reaching out. That's the first step.
Yeah. Will, he got a DUI. His girlfriend left him, so his world is shot.
Yeah.
And he's just drinking every day. He doesn't want to be awake, but eventually you have to be awake at some point to drink water and eat food. And I guess he listened to us prior to this happening, and we were his only outlet because he reached out.
So I wonder if he's been in recovery before then, I'm assuming.
Sounds like it, yeah.
Well,
he needs to go to rehab. He needs to call 988 because he sounds like he's in crisis, actually.
No kidding.
His 988 number should be there, and they should direct him to Arizona and the free resources that are out there. I don't know his insurance situation. I don't know. This is a guy who needs to go someplace and stop the treadmill. Get off the treadmill. Drinking, thinking, feeling sorry for himself. Get off the pity party.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do something. She left you to wake you up. So wake up. Yep. Wake up. She's not coming back.
Absolutely.
Until you're better. Until you want to make her better, then change. Only person that... What's the saying? Only person that can change things is change itself.
Yeah.
So that's where I'm coming from.
Nothing happens.
Medically, I wonder about his medical condition or conditions that were pre-drinking and could be brought on by drinking. I wonder about him stopping without being medically. He's drinking, which is the most dangerous to stop cold turkey, the most dangerous to stop alone. And you always need to be medically detoxed. It's the most dangerous detox to go through, alcohol. And withdrawal is the worst and can end your life. So please get somewhere to a hospital. Let them know your situation. Yeah. State of Arizona, I'm sure, has referrals. And I would go that route. I mean, if you're asking me what to do, if you're listening to me right now, I'm telling you what to do. So do it.
Mike, I'll be willing to bet that Mike's more upset about the girlfriend leaving than he is about the DUI. And that's probably true. All right, so before we close out here, we'd like to pay our respects to the 2,996 souls that were lost 23 years ago today by honoring our flag and our anthem. All right, everybody. Thank you for listening. Will, thank you for coming in. Tommy, can you read the just for today? I put it in the chat.
Yeah, I've got it pulled up, actually.
Very good.
So the just for today from September 11th, 2024 is Bend with the Wind. And the quote from page 265 is, we learn to become flexible. As new things are revealed, we feel renewed. And then from the basic text from page 102, flexibility was not a part of the vocabulary we used in our using days. We'd become obsessed with the raw pleasure of our drugs and hardened to all the softer, subtler, more infinitely varied pleasures of the world around us. Our disease had turned life itself into a constant threat of jails, institutions, and death, a threat against which we hardened ourselves all the more. In the end, we became brittle. With the merest breath of life's wind, we crumbled at last, broken, defeated, with no choice but to surrender. But the beautiful irony of recovery is that in our surrender, we found the flexibility we had lost in our addiction, the very lack of which had defeated us. We regained the ability to bend in life's breeze without breaking. When the wind blew, we felt its loving caress against our skin, where once we would have hardened ourselves as if against the onrush of a storm. The winds of life blow new airs our way each moment, and with them new fragrances, new pleasures, very subtly different. As we bend with life's wind, we feel and hear and touch and smell and taste all it has to offer us. And as the new winds blow, we feel renewed. Just for today, higher power, help me bend with life's wind and glory in its passing. Free me from rigidity.
Very good. Yeah. Rigidity. Tough to help others if you're rigid, you know?
It was very sexual.
Very. Oh, all right. That deserves a timeout thing. Will Douglas, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, we love having your presence on the broadcast.
Hey, Willie.
You guys have any words of wisdom before we hit the road? Don't be rigid.
I'm just sorry to dump the whole... I felt like I was just, I don't know. I'm sorry.
Listen, I was hot. I'm glad you did it, honestly, because it's a new one for me. So, yeah, apparently 12-year-olds are using fentanyl, people. It's a whole new thing to be aware of. That's about it. Good job, everybody. We'll see you on Sunday night, or Monday, later, Baiters.
Peace.